Okay, we just had a dropped Skype connection, but I'll now continue with the explanation. So as a person retains their sexual fluid, they're also retaining the astral energy that would accompany the sexual fluid to create a new child. This allows for a fullness of health within their lower chakras, and it actually will build to move to the upper chakras as well. In the Brahmacharya text, there is discussion of retaining the fluid will then cause that essence to go up to the brain. It's important to understand that the sperm itself does not travel up the spinal cord to the brain, but instead, once there's that surplus of chemicals and nutrients and proteins in the body, that will begin to nourish all parts of the body, including the nervous system. That will build a stronger brain and spine and spinal cord. In addition to that, as that surplus of sexual energy in the non-physical body, in the chakras, is stored, that will naturally start to fill up and essentially fill out all those chakras in wholeness, removing their karmas, and thus causing a natural rise in kundalini energy. So the sexual energy is primarily held in the root chakra. The root chakra is related to the earth element. It's also related to the genitals. The second chakra is often misunderstood and mislabeled as the quote-unquote sexual chakra. The second chakra does relate to the kidneys. It does relate to the uterus as well in some respects. I should say it relates more to the ovaries, but even that's not wholly true. The earth element is the most dominant element in sexual reproduction and in the ovaries and in the uterus as well. The second chakra gives us the emotional connection to another person and that nourishing aspect of sexuality. Healthy second chakra is even created just by having nourishing friendships, even if there's no sexual exchange. The root chakra, however, actually manufactures, I should say, the organs associated with the root chakra actually manufacture the physical substance that will become the child, and the root chakra generates the energy that adds physical substance to the uterus, or I should say to the fetus that's growing inside the uterus. And so the earth element and the root chakra is truly the most important chakra in sexuality. It's that which adds substance to the growing child. It's that which manufactures the physical substance to create new life with. And so as a person naturally holds more sexual energy, the root chakra is going to get filled up, and it's going to start to heal any areas of weakness or imbalance. It's going to create greater health in the genital organs as well. The sexual energy is then going to overflow, and more of that life force energy is going to start filling out the second chakra. And on and up it'll go, naturally filling out all the areas of weakness within the lower chakras. It's very important to know that the emotions and our thoughts are related to the karma or the patterns in our different chakras. And so a person can be practicing celibacy or brahmacharya, and they can still be manifesting behaviors of thought and emotion that are draining their energies. And so they may never be able to store enough energy to completely fill out and heal a chakra. It's not that the practice is not successful. It's not that they're failing at their celibacy or sexual retention, but rather their practice is not complete. They are not looking at and examining the other parts of spiritual growth that are supportive to this brahmacharya path. And so regardless of what path a person takes, I feel that there must always be the experience of knowledge. And so we have to learn what's going on inside of our emotions, inside of our chakras, and with that knowledge comes the understanding of what to change to improve our experiences. As we change, then we gain new knowledge. And so we apply our knowledge to transform our experience, and back and forth we go until we reach mastery of that experience and health of that chakra. This is one thing that's often misunderstood or neglected, and perhaps purposefully neglected, in the ancient Brahmacharya teachings, particularly the books. In India, they have a cultural trend of I should say, a cultural habit of exclaiming everything that someone is promoting as being God-born, God-blessed, great, perfect, transcendence of all suffering. So when we look at any ancient Indian text, we'll almost always find that there's claims of this being the greatest path, this being the perfect path, all of your sins, all of your troubles, all of your problems will be taken away if you just do this one thing. It's a beautiful sales pitch, but I don't feel it's accurate based upon experience. Retaining your sexual energy and your sexual fluids is going to give you more energy. But if you haven't removed the ways that you're using your energy in an ineffective way, then you're still going to be losing some of the energy you're gaining, and you're not going to reach the greatest benefit. And so it's very common that many people practicing the celibacy path are still performing behaviors or having thoughts and emotions that are in some way reducing all of the energy that they're gaining from this restrictive self-control practice. Some people in the Brahmacharya path will have lust because they've never actually understood why they're still desiring something else. This returns back to why I feel very strongly that Brahmacharya is accurately defined as walking with God, and it's not just the path of celibacy. A person can be celibate and not get enlightened, but a person who walks with God will get enlightened, whether or not they're celibate. It doesn't matter so much to me if they are sexually active or not, it's how they understand their sexual energies and how they work with their sexual energies. Self-control must always be there, whether celibate or active. But to make it a true Brahmacharya path, a person must bring that divine aspect from within into their mind, body, and emotions. The celibacy may come as a byproduct, as a result, because sexual desire may release oneself. They may no longer have sexual desires when they feel emotionally filled up with the love of God. So the celibacy is what we may see in a physical sense, but the inner workings, the inner important part, that's going to be that connection to God within. And when we feel connected with God within, we don't have desires for lust because we're not seeking anything from the external world. There's no more weaknesses or dark or lacking areas in our mind, emotions, or chakras. So as we store more energy, we're going to start to give greater health in body and emotion. As the emotions become more healthy and as the body becomes more healthy, we're going to be able to concentrate our mind better. We're going to have greater inner peace. We're going to have greater functions in our intuition, in any psychic abilities. As these chakras start to fill up, they make changes in our experience. In many of the Indian paths, they talk about siddhis, and those are the magic abilities that we gain as we awaken. I don't feel they're magic at all. In fact, my experience is that many people who are greedy and practice so-called magic don't actually get these abilities. They delude themselves into believing they have them. It's very common that people who feel they're psychic are not truly psychic. They're just believing that their own mental projections are psychically accurate. And with a simple trial and error test, we can see how accurate they truly are. As I said, my experience is that all of these cities awaken as we expand ourselves to become a greater part of the universe. And it's simply the case that we're increasing our communication abilities with what's around us. So we have inner vision, and we have telepathic communication, and we have empathy, or we have energy mastery, because we've now expanded ourselves. We remove these walls of limitation. So there are many things that can happen as specific manifestations as you retain more energy in your body and your emotions, but the underlying benefit is the retaining of energy that would otherwise have been lost, and as this energy is retained, it's used more fully by your body and your emotions. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, that was great. On the subject of the emotional changes that you are mentioning and how it relates back to how people can be celibate and still not reach enlightenment. For a long time, I'm skipping to my fourth question, and we'll go back to my third one. But I just was wondering. So for me, lust has always been like my chief source of suffering. I don't feel much anger. I don't feel much prideful or greedy. But I do feel perhaps greed in the form of physical, like, lust. So I guess in the week or so that I've been retaining my sexual fluids, like, I have experienced various phenomena. For example, sudden, almost uncontrollable energy in my lower body, like my legs are bouncing up and down while I'm sitting, working or so, or whatever, a constant quivering or bubbling of energy in my lower torso and legs, kind of often when I'm sleeping at night. A couple nights ago, I woke numerous times during the night, highly aroused, like my heart was beating fast, and I was the third time it happened, I finally released those sexual fluids, and I don't, you know, another thing relating to the second thing I mentioned about the kind of quivering energy in my lower torso, but it's sort of, I've experienced an increased energetic awareness as I'm being more aware of my body when I cease to release those fluids. I mean, trying to increase, I'm noticing more of the lower three chakras, at least predominantly very low. I'm not really sure which of the three it is, but certainly the root chakra has much more energy. And I've never really been able to sense my lower three chakras. When I've done your chakra meditation CDs, you start in the lower chakras and move up, that natural progression. And I have not felt much in the lower area regions of my body. Perhaps I'm guessing because I've expelled frequently my fluids, so it's not retaining that energy. But I don't know. I guess I've always interpreted this in the past as restless energy, and sought the release to calm myself. But after, it's gotten sometimes as bad as like physically shaking, like with almost this excited energy. I'm just wondering what ways you would recommend or the Brahmacharya path recommends for coping with these increased energies in the body.
Okay. Yeah, I'm happy to help. My experience is that I've never came across any recommendations in any of the ancient texts to help with this, and often there's a lack of mention about these types of symptoms. I feel that the reason why they're not mentioned is because it would damage the reputation and the sales pitch, or the quality of the sales pitch, of these spiritual books. Oftentimes in spiritual books, we see an overabundance of the greatness and the benefits of the spiritual path, and we do not at all see any recognition of the difficulties of the spiritual path. And in my experience, India in particular has done a wonderful job selling spirituality, making a very romantic display of what spirituality should be. The reality, however, is that as we gain more spiritual energy, particularly in the Brahmacharya path, there's going to be symptoms manifesting as your body starts to transform itself and as your energy system starts to transform itself. One of the best analogies that I can give will relate to electricity. If we have a light bulb, that is a 10-watt light bulb, it's a very weak light bulb, and we put a current through that light bulb that is too strong, the light bulb will burst. In order to contain a higher current, we have to build a stronger light bulb. As you start to retain your own energies in yourself, you're retaining higher and higher amounts of energy. This is encouraging your body to build stronger nerves, stronger tissue, and stronger energy system channels. In the beginning, as you retain this energy, it will be uncomfortable, or it could be uncomfortable, because your system is not able to handle this higher frequency. Particularly if a person has been sexually active either alone or with a partner since puberty, they're never going to have had the opportunity to store a lot of sexual energy, And therefore, their nerves and their tissue and even their energy system would never have been built stronger.